How many?
12, 3, 2.
And we're live! We did it! Woo!
It happened, man.
It happened, I know.
Yeah.
Thanks so much for hanging in there with us. What's up, everyone? I'm Peely here for Fun for Life Radio on Dash. And how freaking lucky am I that I am in the presence of an amazing singer, songwriter, the one and only LP.
Wow! What's up? Hi, everyone.
How are you?
Everyone? I'm good. I'm just, you know, relaxing. It's nice and hot in here. I like it.
I know.
It's good.
Yeah, you guys can't feel the heat, but it's pretty caliente in here.
Muy caliente.
Ooh!
Every once in a while, that high school Spanish comes out.
Well, and also all your fans from like Mexico and El Salvador. I'm sure they've taught you some Spanish.
Yeah, you know, I got some people in the wings
helping you.
Helping me with my Spanish, I guess.
Girl, what a week you've had. I mean, yeah. You had 2 drive-in concerts on Saturday.
Yeah.
You performed on Seth Meyers' show on Tuesday. You dropped a single, How Low Can You Go, today.
Yeah.
How you feeling?
I feel good. I feel, I feel like productive, you know, it's nice. Like, that's like the biggest thing, you know, I want in my life, in my career, in my work. I want to, continuously, you know, put things out, like creative outlets. It's just like, I mean, that's the way for me. And I just feel it's nice. Like, I don't know, I always feel like super connected to my peeps, you know, hi, when I do that. So it's like, I'm always looking to do that at any point. You know, like, I'm sitting on so many songs right now that it's hard sometimes to like contain my enthusiasm.
Cause right.
I'm ready to go like, you know, I'm ready to drop a SoundCloud, you know, like just, I'm ready to leak all my own songs.
Right. Yeah. You're like, so, it leaked. I wonder who it was.
I have to fight that.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard you say that some years you've written 80 to 100 songs. I'm sure you've slowed down a little now that you're on tour.
Well, you know, like, it's like kind of like also quality, not quantity sometimes. And I don't like, you know, when I wrote for other people, yeah, more so. But like now with me, I feel like, you know, I feel like I often make it count. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
It's like, I'm like, if I get too many, if I write too much, then I just get a little like all over the place. Like, I don't know what to... And so, and you know, there are songs that I can't even remember. I don't like, I'll be like, even on this record, I'll be like, shit, I wanted that song on this record. And it's not, I don't have any room. It's not going to make it. Like a song I wrote, in like last summer,
mm-hmm.
You know, like, who knows when that's coming.
You know? I was going to say, like, what do you do with those songs? Do you like hold them?
I hold them, you know, and then every once in a while, like, you know, somebody else will like want it. And depending on how much I want it, I'll be like,
I thought you were going to say, depending on how much they're going to pay for it.
Yeah, no, it would, you know, depending how big they are, how much they want to pay, you know, I don't know. I mean, I know when something is like, I have to do it myself, you know, or I want to do it myself. It means a lot to me, or I feel like it's important to my, you know, body of work.
Have you tuned into that because of all this experience that you've had? And have you ever given someone a song that you were like, damn it, I should have kept that one.
No, I get asked that often, and I just have one example of a song that I wish I didn't take. I didn't want to take it. I had a song, I've told this story many times, but I had a song that Shakira and her people wanted, and I really wanted to give it to her. Oh, I wanted to give it to Shakira.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure you wanted to give it to Shakira.
I did. I wanted to give her that song. And and then my manager at the last minute, he's here. He's forever on my shit list about that, but no. But he was, I think he got nervous in the label meeting, like kind of like, you know, do we have the, you know, the one that they're like dying to put out as a first single? And then he just like kind of, he put that on them. He played it for them and they were all like, what is this?
Right.
What the hell is this? You know, I mean, you know, just like, here come the bullshit wheels, you know, like kicking into motion. And then they took it from her, and she really wanted it. So, like, you know, her people and her, you know, I wasn't on the phone with her. I'm like, yeah, I'm sorry. Sorry, she can't. No, don't be mad. But, yeah, I'll leave this guy. What's up, man?
What's up, man?
Yeah. Play that banjo.
We're live here. Fishbowl.
Fishbowl.
Hollywood Boulevard. Yeah. A lot of people coming in and out.
And anyway,
cool.
So I didn't take it, but I always felt like she would have, like, if we could, it's called Night Like This, and it was like, it's on my record Forever For Now. And when I sing it, it's like super sweet and like a lullaby-ish kind of thing. And you know, and then I remember I heard a woman sing it more from like this, like more a very feminine perspective and like almost like a, but a, I don't want to say sexy because I don't want to bring that into it, but
yeah.
It was kind of more like a romantic thing. And I was just like, oh shit.
Oh man.
That would have been good. So that's the only time I ever had a song where I like, you know, where I was like, and not even, you know, just the money of like Shakira singing it. Which I'm sure would be good.
Yeah.
But it's just also just for me, you know, it's just like as an artist, I want to hear like the best version of a song. And that's why, you know, I kind of make that call when I'm like, I think I might do the best version of something, but, and this person will do the best version.
So how do you know that a song is ready? How do you know that a song is good? I mean, I know you can't predict if it's going to be a hit. That's not the question.
Yeah.
The question is, what makes a song good?
That I can't stop listening to it, you know? Like when I get a demo, like sometimes I'll have a demo, like a voice memo demo. Like I'll just take it off the board. A lot of times I do that. And if I listen to it like 10 times in the car on the way home, I'm like, this has got some potential. Like,
right.
I can't, like, you know, people, I've you know, I write duds too. Everybody does. You know, someone will send me a song and I'd be like, yep, never gonna listen to that again. Click, bye. Yeah, I don't need to ever listen to like certain songs again. So
right.
Whatever, you know.
So LP are your initials. Why and when did you choose to go by LP?
Back in the day in New York City, I did. I was working at a restaurant, or a bar, whatever. And
were you a waitress?
I was a bartender.
Okay.
And
I was a cocktail waitress in New York, so I get it.
And a bartender. Yeah, and there was another Laura that had been working there for a while. So and I remember I had a friend. When I at summer camp when I was a kid, that called me LP, and it always kind of made me go like, yeah, maybe like, I don't know, it resonated with me, but I didn't, you know, I didn't really know that you could just change your name. I mean, that would have saved me some fucking time, I gotta be honest. But like but I think that it just, you know, and it pissed, you know, even my girlfriend at the time was not so happy about like. Because it started to progress, and then everybody was calling me LP, and then she would call me Laura in front of them, and they would be like, and then they'd try to call me Laura or something like that, and I'd be like, yo, no.
You're like, I don't know who you're talking about.
I'm
LP, people.
I didn't think that, like, it was going to get to a point. Like, I didn't name myself different. It was just on a lark, and then my band started calling me that at the time, and I just, like, it just kept feeling good.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't realize that I was, like, abandoning my, you know, birth name, but now it doesn't even feel like my name. And so when people I think try to call it me that as a measure of like being more intimate or being more like, you know, like respect or something like that, I'm like, yeah, no, that's not that's not my name.
Right.
Yeah.
That's not my name.
that's not my name.
So exactly. When you hear songs like Good With You, that was 2006, right?
Good With You.
Yeah.
That came out actually 2008.
2008.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
When you hear songs like that, and then you hear songs like How Low Can You Go, which is your new single, what's the biggest difference? Where do you think you've evolved the most?
Well, you know, the thing is, what happened is that when I get into these places, when I got into these big major label deals, I was like, I was trying to, you know, in my like younger head, do. Not do what they said, but play the game.
Right.
You know what I mean? Trying
yeah.
to get through with myself as much intact as possible. And, you know, and I like, you know, and it's not a story. I don't, like, talk a good story, like, about being myself and swaggering into the label, you know, like, hey, oh, yeah? You don't like it? Well, fuck you. You know, I mean, I'm like that now. But, like, in the beginning, you know, like, these guys are giving you all this money, and you're trying to, like, you're, you know, when you get signed, everybody says, and, you know, rightly so, that's the beginning. Then you're like in this like foot race with every single person that's like trying to get to be a priority at this label.
You keep having to prove yourself.
Yeah, oh, in every way. I mean, even now, I like, you know, like it's great, you know? I mean, I think that's what makes you ultimately a better human and a better artist, is to like continually, you know, try to improve yourself and improve yourself.
Right.
And so I just think that you know, I allowed, I didn't allow it, but I also just was like kind of getting all this knowledge. I started writing songs, and at such a like fast level, to go back to the writing a lot, you know, because when you're on a major, like as a solo artist, they just start putting you with all, and you're a vocal person, you know, you have a certain like level of voice that they're like, we gotta get the song for the voice, you know, and so you just write with all these people, and it's very, you know, you're like, wow, I gotta write, you know, so, and they're trying to find a sound, right. You know, and I had all these sounds. That's the biggest thing that I think is like what people like about me now is that I have a bunch of elements that are, you know, easy to see and also a little more like kind of where did, how, you know, like when someone comes to see my show, I think I'm like, you know, kind of a rock artist, mm-hmm. really, even though I seem pop or alternative to people. I don't know what the hell they think, you know what I mean? But I'm unapologetically like, you know, yeah, mm-hmm. I'm like, I'm kind of just doing whatever I feel. So, but all that craziness and all the labels and then writing for other people really kind of just like made me kind of like get better at, or not even, yes, get better, but like really have all this like kind of like range, I think.
And confidence too, right? Because yeah. I mean, we see LP and we see someone that's super confident. Mm-hmm. You know, we see like swagger, we see, I'm just like, I want to be like that, you know? Yeah. We want to be that confident. Have
well,
you always
you
been
can
like
be like
that?
And then you'd be like screaming inside. I've always
right.
been outwardly.
That's true. That's true.
I've been outwardly like that, yeah, for a very long time. For, you know, I mean, all my life, like, people always trying to beat it out of me, like, kind of like, who the hell do you think you are? I'm like, I don't know. Who are you? I don't really care, you know, like, walk around like you own the place until you own the place.
I wonder if it's a New York thing, too.
I guess so. I think it's like my dad was like a super maniac, tough guy. And I think that like, I felt very protected. I'd be like, oh yeah, fuck you.
Right.
Like behind his back, like, yeah. What are you gonna do? What are you gonna do?
Right, right.
And he'd be like, run. And I just feel like I feel pretty protected. And I don't know, I feel like I could talk myself out of kind of anything if I had to.
Talking about your dad, you've mentioned before that your dad, he wasn't that keen on you pursuing an artistic
yeah.
career.
Yeah.
Would you, you know, he's passed now, but would you want him to know how successful you are now?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, I think he, you know, the thing, as it went on, like, he knew, like, even, like, I don't know, he had a friend that was, like, you know, in the entertainment business that was like, oh, no, you know, she's got something, you know,
right.
like, and he respected this person and was like, I don't know, and he always felt something. I think he was a very sentimental kind of guy. You know, like he was tone deaf, couldn't sing a note or anything or do any music. But you know, he was like that guy who would play a song over and over and over and over and over and over again. So I think he was like kind of touched that I could sing. It's like if your kid's, you know, good at anything, you know,
mm-hmm.
like so he got it. And I think, you know, when I started getting, he died like right after like my first big record deal, and I feel like he was like, oh shit,
right?
You
yeah.
know, but I mean, I think a lot of people were like kind of like, because no one, everybody wants results. It's like even like, you know, family. I don't think like extended family really kind of it sank in until I did like David Letterman or something like that. They're
right,
like, you know, like. You know, like you go like, well, you know, I may not be giant or anything yet or whatever, you know, but I'm not crazy. Well, I'm crazy, but I'm not crazy. So yeah, you know, it's just like it's a journey, and that's why, like, you know, humility and being humble is just like, you know, that's the way, because it's like confidence is different than arrogance and
100%.
So I think that, you know, it's always there's always someone bigger, better. You know, and it should be like that, isn't it?
Right,
you
know, of course. Like competition's always good too, you know, it
yeah.
pushes you.
And I think everybody has a place, you know. Like when I was really young, I was in Amsterdam and I was like stoned out of my mind on Space Cake, and I remember just like watching MTV and being like in a cafe all alone. I was like, because I was just starting to be like, I wanna maybe do music, and I was like, Jesus Christ, I can't do that. Look at these people.
So you were stopping yourself? Yeah. You're probably like watching like Britney
oh my
Spears
God.
Or something.
I was like,
and you're
yeah,
like,
what? I was like,
you
know,
with a snake?
Yeah, and then now, you know, if I walk into like, you know, I mean, I'll be like in somewhere in Europe and go into like, you know, some MTV office and I'll be like, I'll see my video like before or after a, you know, a Justin Bieber video or something and be like, holy crap, that's odd. You know?
Yeah, those are the pinch me moments, right?
Yeah. I was like, it's weird.
Well, you deserve it. I mean, you're so freaking, oh, it's true. But, you know, talking about that, who deserves it, you know, at the end of the day, too? Because there's so many amazing, talented people exactly. out there.
Yeah, I mean, you know, make your head spin. Like, you know, that was also, but I would tell you, and I tell this story always, like, to inspire other people, you know, but I've worked with so many people as a writer, like, when I was just writing for other people, and I had no end in sight. There was no, like, oh, I'm going to be an artist again, truly. From 2009 to 2011, there was no...
Which for me is like mind-blowing. I'm like, for a minute there, you were just going to not sing and just be a songwriter and never sing again.
Yeah, and I sing the demos, you know. I was like, that's cool.
That would have been so bad for like humanity in general. You would have deprived them of
so
Well,
that's nice. I appreciate that. But like, I think that I was very, you know, I felt like I was, that was some immersive learning because there's great, I think there's great value in, you know, being void of expectations, you know. It's like one of the things I've definitely learned in my life, like, don't put expectations on anything. And I felt very, like, you know, kind of like in a survival mode, but in creative survival mode, you know. And I think that it was interesting what happened to my writing and all that in that place. But what I was talking about is, like working with all these artists and seeing careers either go or falter, and for no reason, like, you know, you'd have some like young woman or young man come in, they're like, you know, 20 years old, they can sing like unbelievable, they've got, you know, they had one song that did kind of well, or they haven't, but they're like on a fast track. All the A&R guys are like, there's a priority, it's a priority, unbelievable, like, you know, and you would bet your whole life that this person would just
become a star.
Yeah, and I will tell you that, unfortunately, maybe 98% of the time, I never heard of that person again once I was done working with them or whatever, you know? That's tough, you know?
I mean,
I wasn't the only person. It wasn't like, they're like, yeah, because you didn't write them a good song. Sorry about that. but I mean, everybody in the industry was working with this person.
Right,
you know?
Right,
and you
right.
think for sure.
So they had all the machinery behind them, like pushing them.
Yeah, and that's another thing that really gave me like the confidence to like keep going, because I was like, no one, you know, like, and I do remember, like, even like, I forgot to say that in that cafe in Amsterdam when I was out of my mind watching MTV, doubting myself, I just felt this like voice kind of going like, everybody's career is different.
You know, everybody like, has their own path.
Everybody has their own path, and you're no different. Like, just do your own path. Like, right. I mean, you know, it'd be very difficult to duplicate my path for someone to be like, well, what did you do? It's like,
you don't want to.
Woo,
I mean, you got dropped so many times.
Don't get into it. Like, you know, like, let's
skip
not
that part.
Go there.
You know, Lost on You was only about 3 years ago, right? That I came out?
Four years ago,
right? I mean, but you had such a huge career before that nobody, not that nobody had ever.
Well, I
heard
had like
of,
an indie thing, you know?
Yeah,
what I mean,
like, I remember watching you here in Bardot at school nights.
Yeah.
Like, 8 or 7 years ago, and being like, who the fuck is this girl? Oh,
well, that was
my
right,
lord.
That was right in my writing mode. That was, you know, that night changed my path, I think, because, you know.
Because I was there?
Because you were there. Absolutely. That was a big thing about it. And I was like, I was doing it for fun, you know. And every time I started having fun, people were like, oh, what are you doing?
Mm.
You know? And, so I went there, you know, I would go there my friend recommended that I sing there, and then when I started singing there, the guy who ran the show, Jason Scopa, was just like, yo, you gotta do it again and again. And then people started coming to see me, and they were kind of like, oh, you came out of nowhere. I was like, you know, I had already been touring for years and years, and I knew how to, like, perform, you know, but it really got me back in the swing of wanting to perform, and loving it and sharing it, you know. Mm-hmm. I felt like, and people like started to come, and it was like, and it kind of was a perfect storm. I'd gotten a Rihanna single, my song got picked Into the Wild got picked for this big Citibank commercial. And then, you know, and Warner Brothers was like courting me and some other, you know, and then at the end of 2011, I just got signed, that song came out, and I had like a burst, you know. And then, you know, unfortunately there were some extenuating circumstances at the label afterwards that then kind of like dismantled what I...
Yeah, I mean, it's unbelievable. Like, you play Lost on You for this, the new team, and they're like,
three years later, after they completely botched the single release of Into the Wild that had like a huge like moment on a commercial, which is like what they always ask for, you know, and then it took too long to put the record out, and then everybody that loved me was either fired or left.
Gone.
And then the new people who just didn't get me, like, and you know, that's the thing. That's the thing with... being an artist, like, and whether, you know, I could beat up on myself and be like, oh, well, I don't look like this or that. But, you know, people either like, but I had people that many times that were like, yo, that's just weird enough in my work. But no, I mean, seriously, like, I had people that were like, holy crap, you know, this person has something. And then when you're in front of someone that does not think you have something, it's right. Like going on a bad date.
You're like a really, really bad date.
You're like, this person does not want to fuck me.
Right.
It's like... Yeah, please. You know, like kind of that moment. And so I get in there and I play them, you know, my fans will appreciate this. They've heard this story 1,000 times. But I play them Lost in You, I play them Muddy Waters, and I play them Strange. And they're like,
is this over yet?
Yeah, those were fantastic. Thank you.
Did you know right away when you stepped out of that room that it wasn't happening?
I don't know. You know, I didn't, like, I hated that guy so much.
Yeah.
You know, he's such a, like, you know, just a, you know, I just, because I look at some of these people and I go, why are you here?
Right.
You were like, you drummed for Sheryl Crow for 10 years? Oh, congratulations. Now you're an expert in music. Get the fuck out
of here. Right,
Like, you know, like, I just, like, I don't respect them. Like, so, like, whatever. Like, you know, like, go ahead. Hi, people. Oh, thank you. They know, oh, I love you too. Thanks.
Well,
how
people,
cool is that?
Yeah, there you go. Some fans out here, but people who do respect you are the ones that are watching us here on the live stream. We encourage you guys to ask any questions for LP. I do have my friend Sarah here writing down some of the questions, so let us know where you're tuning in from. You're watching Fun for Life Radio on Dash. I'm Peely, and here is LP with me. LP, something that blows my mind, and actually, I don't know if you know who Sebastian Chris is. He's an amazing producer. He's won like 12 Grammys. He's worked with Shakira, Ricky Martin, Luis Fonsi.
Put in a good word, would you?
But he's seen you play a bunch of times, and he called me, and he's like, oh my God, you're interviewing LP. She's such an amazing talent. And I'm like, can you believe that she's never been nominated to a Grammy?
You know.
I mean, he's like, we got to talk about this. This needs to change, like, right away. Like,
are you listening? God, are you listening?
Is that something that you think about?
No, I try not to think about that.
But you wish God was listening.
You know, listen, I mean, it's wonderful to be recognized by, you know, your country,
colleagues,
your country at all, basically. But by people. I think, you know, I think I'll always stick to this thing. Like, even, you know, even now, people have no idea. There's, you know, there's many places where many people know, of course. I'm always kind of like, wow, I'm so lucky, it's so like cool. But like, people won't know, and then they'll look you up and they'll be like, oh.
Yep, they'll be like, holy
and,
shit.
I think that's always the subtle thing that I like. You know, I like, I always like the thing like, who would you want to be if you could be Mick Jagger or this guy? This is awesome.
Hello.
Who would you be if you could be like Mick Jagger or Keith Richards? You know, and not that Keith Richards is not as famous, you know, but I still think he's always was like,
he has a better.
Yeah, he just was like chill, and I love Mick Jagger. I mean, I love them equally now, but I always would like want to be, like, the kind of cool, like, chill, side guy.
Plus, you can keep some of your privacy in the U.S. You know,
yeah,
you can go
exactly.
to like a store next door, and no one's gonna be like,
You know, I mean, I think it's like I truly have a beautiful career. I have beautiful fans. I have such a, you know, I have the exact level that, you know, I love, and I'm always, you know, I always say I can handle this, I can handle more. I'm like good, you know.
Right.
I'm like, and I'm no matter what, like less, whatever. I'm just like, you know, I'm gonna put out songs.
Yay.
And that's my plan. I don't, you know, it's like, again, the no expectations things. Like you can screw yourself over with, you know, too much. of that kind of ambition, but it's, it, you know, but it's good to keep a little, to keep that drive and to keep, you know, the desire to create, and that's something I hope I never lose.
100%. Well, talking about songs, on my show Truth and Tunes here on Fun for Life Radio on Dash, the real concept is for amazing cultural influencers such as yourself to come in and share those five songs that have influenced and shaped their lives in some form. So let's start with those songs.
It's a really hard question.
I was going to ask you,
I went super classic on it, you know, but I can name, like, you know, current songs and stuff like that. But I feel like, and also I didn't even, you know, this was one of those things that, like, you know, Talia was just like, you have to answer these questions, you have to answer these questions, you have to pick these five songs,
I keep emailing your team, I'm like, guys, I need those five songs.
I was like, I just go on Spotify, okay, I love David Bowie, bam, you know, like, I mean, there's so many, so many songs, you know, but anyway, carry on.
All right, no, but it's funny because out of all the guests that I've had, only one, which was Rudy Sarso, he's a bass player for Quiet Riot and Whitesnake and Ozzy Osbourne. He was like, oh no, this was super easy for me to pick these five songs. I'm like, you're the only guest that I've ever had that has said that this wasn't a challenge.
A lot of artists are like that. I'm always like, it's like, who are your influences? I'm like, oh God. My mind goes totally fucking mad. I'm just like, meh.
All right, well, let's start with a huge influence for a lot of people.
Okay.
And it's David Bowie.
Yeah.
And it's Suffragette City.
Suffragette City. you know, I'm honestly, I could have gone Changes. I could have gone, you know, all kinds of things, you know. But I feel like Suffragette City is just like so like, it's just a rock. I'm, like I said, I'm like kind of a rocker kind of person. And, you know, and it's got that, like, I don't know, he's just always, it's just like his writing is so crazy. It's like the way he like can just make something that's never been heard before, a hook, like not something that's never been heard before, but like he can, like, he melds genres, speaking of that, very, very interestingly. And you know, and he's one of my idols for sure, because, you know, speaking of like a body of work, he's one of those people that I feel like you know, was putting out incredible stuff until the last breath.
You know,
that last record he put out was as good as, and you know, any of his early shit. And I just was like floored, you know. And it was really, and it wasn't trying to be his early shit, you know. It was like, it was just very, you know, it was kind of just right in his
real
kind of lane, you know, that he's always done, you know, and right up until the very end. And that's like so inspiring to me.
Plus his style, you know, and obviously you have an amazing style too. And he, you know, he played around with being androgynous too. He wasn't afraid of doing that.
Yeah, long time ago, I was working at a bar, and a friend of mine was like, "Yo, do you?" I'm like, she was an artist. She was a customer at the thing, and I think she was actually someone that introduced me to like one of my first voice teachers or something. And she had had some success and stuff, and she was opening for him.
What?
Yeah, in this park thing. It was like this kind of chill, like, park in Manhattan that was like having this small show. Like, sometimes things like that just happen. They're just like kind of like, you know, like they're unannounced, people don't know, and whatever. So she played, and then I got to see David Bowie, and I never seen
him. I'm so jealous.
And I was like, and he was just, you know, in a simple, like, you know, I always like kind of like this look on him, and I, you know, I kind of try to emulate that, you know, at times, but just like a simple silk shirt and you know, trousers, whatever, and this fucking guy like flipped between like being a man and a woman like every 5 minutes, like 5 seconds, you know, at times. And it was so precise. Like, I was like, he looked like some beautiful, like, you know, elegant woman, and once, like, then he'd be like this kind of like, you know, skinny swaggering rock star. All of a sudden I was just like, it was blowing my mind.
Oh, that's awesome. Have you seen that video? Do you know who Stromae is from France?
Who?
Stromae.
Oh, yeah, yeah, of course.
He has an amazing video where he goes from male to female.
Yeah.
You should check it out. It's pretty amazing.
Why not?
All right, so let's hear a minute of Suffragette.
Suffragette City.
There you go, Suffragette.
Suffra.
Yeah, so you guys, as you know, or you may not know, but now you're learning, I'm ESL. English as a second language right here. So
that's a hard one, because it's like, there's no word that's suffra. There's like suffer, which, you know, that's why he's trying to say it like that. But it's like I don't know if it's a fictitious place or a real place, unfortunately. And if it's fictitious, then I'm like, what a great word to make up.
Right.
Suffragette. I mean, that's you can like spend a whole like book on why he would choose that.
Well, thank you for teaching me how to pronounce it.
Oh, hell yeah.
I appreciate that, LP.
My pleasure.
All right. Well, here you go, guys. Enjoy a minute of Suffragette
City.
There you go. Thank you.
Yeah. Is it more difficult to write songs or like for other people than for yourself? That is like that's in every single interview I've ever done.
Well, not this one. I haven't asked that one.
I know. I love
Yay!
It. So
winning at the interview. Oh, we're back.
Hey, and we're back.
All right. So that was Suffragette City.
And don't forget, Suffragette. Yes. Is the movement like the suffragettes were the women that like fought for the right to vote for women. Sorry, I forgot about that. And
A little history lesson.
I should like my history teacher would should be shocked.
She'd be like, LP, I taught you.
Actually, she would. You know, I want to tell this devilish story.
Please do. We love devilish stories.
I was working at a lesbian bar, and she came in, and she never liked me. Like, she did not like me, probably because she was like, this kid's on to me. Because she was like, I was like, my husband, my kids, and I'm fine with it. But I was just like, you know, like, right. So anyway, so one day she comes in the bar and she goes, and she was like, you know, she was like kind of a badass, but she was like, you know, I'm a scout concern. I'm like, sure. And I literally went like this. I was like, I know who you are. How creepy, right? Wait, and I'm like, and she's
hi,
like,
Mrs. Smith.
And then she just looks at me like, and I was like, I was in your social studies class in school. And she goes, nah, you must have been smart because it was like an AP class,
right,
or whatever.
Right.
And I swear to God, I like turned around to like answer the phone or something like that. And I turn back and she's gone.
She's like disappeared.
Like the door was like spinning, you know? And I'm like, sorry.
I love that.
Yeah.
Karma, anyway, huh?
I mean, I don't know. She was just always kind of like, Greg Lacy. You know, I was like, why does this fucking chick hate me? You know?
Right.
I just like digging up old stuff for you.
What a great story, though. Yeah, I would have been like, here you go, Professor Smith, or whatever.
I know you,
and I know the truth. Yeah. How's your husband doing?
How the kids? How's the husband? Right. How's the side piece, the girlfriend?
All right, before we go to the second song that you chose for Truth and Tunes, we're going to answer some questions for the audience. All right, we have a good one from Brogan Scott from the UK. He's watching on YouTube, and he's saying, I mean, I actually don't know if, oh, it's a she. I was going to say, I don't know if Brogan is probably a girl. Okay, so hi, Brogan. Is it?
I'm going to ask if that's a real name. What a dick. Sorry. Okay, Brogan.
Yeah, Brogan, yes.
What do you got?
Is it difficult to draw on negative emotions in music when it comes to the reactions of family or friends who may take it personally?
When, in my own music, you think? Is that what you mean? Okay.
Yeah.
You know, I can't, honestly, what I write, what I say, what I perform or do in a video or whatever is my creative right, and I don't care what anybody thinks or says about it. love you. Love you, uncle, blah, 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 whatever, you know. No, they don't.
And all your exes.
No, they, you know, I mean, dude, I'm so far gone with my family. They're just like, okay. All right.
I mean,
yeah,
I,
they don't care.
I get you. I totally get you. Yeah. I lost both of my parents this year, and, like, my sisters kind of, like, pushed me aside, too. And I'm like, I love them, but yeah. I'm like, I feel so free.
Yeah, man, you know.
There's
I
a
don't,
freedom to
you
it,
can't
you know?
Allow that. You can't allow it, you know, and that's the thing, you know. You got to be, like, freedom for
right.
yourself at all times, you know.
And enjoy it. All right, the next song that you chose for Truth and Tunes is such a classic, such an amazing long song, but unfortunately we're only going to play 1 minute of it. It's from Queen, from their 1975 album, yeah. A Night at the Opera, which actually is interesting because your mom studied opera, right?
She did. I mean, that's the whole thing of this song, is that she played a lot of opera in the house, and I would hear that, you know, and... But I loved, like, you know, I loved hearing pop music too, even though it was like only on, you know, radio stuff. But I remember I was like after soccer practice or something like that, and I was in like my friend's pool, like kind of like, you know, just living my life. And I heard that song kind of like piping outside. They were playing records or whatever,
and you're like, what
like,
is
yo,
this?
What the fuck?
Yeah.
Like, and I just because I couldn't like. I couldn't wrap my head around the like rock format with the like kind of soaring kind of more like vocal, and also just the I mean you know the arrangement of that song is ridiculous.
Right.
So I just you know I was very like kind of like I didn't know what was happening. You know there was so many different parts to that song and so you know it's always inspiring. It's like that you know like kind of like you know Stairway to Heaven those songs that you're just like, how did anyone get that shit through?
Right.
Which is you know. Even more fascinating now, but the story behind it and just also just the song in general. It's just like a masterpiece.
Yeah, we're talking about Bohemian Rhapsody, and I don't know if you know this, but in an interview during the band's Australian tour in 85, Freddie said, it was basically three songs that I wanted to put out, and I just put the three together. Yeah. Has that happened to you?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I've only done it with like two songs, putting them together. And I'm not sure. I don't quite remember if any of that I must have put on a record, but I can't remember what song that is. I think it's sometimes more, it's just like, they're not necessarily songs, they're just ideas. Like, I'll be at a session and we'll be like, you know, just making up all this crap.
Right.
And they'll be like, oh, what if you like link these together, you know? And I mean, that song sounds like that, but the way it moves, it's like a, you know, a three-act play, so it's perfect.
All right, well, here you go, guys. You get to hear a minute of Bohemian Rhapsody
right.
by Queen.
I see a little solo. Scalabouche. How do you say Scalabouche? Come on, Billy.
Scalabouche, Scalabouche.
Scalabouche. That's right.
Yeah, I did it.
You nailed it.
And of course, we're off the air when that happens.
We're on Instagram.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide. No escape from reality. Open your eyes. Look up to the skies and see. I'm just a poor boy. I need no sympathy. Because I'm easy come, easy go. Little high, little low. Any way the wind blows doesn't really matter.
So, I mean, what am I leaving for? What do I got?
We have three more songs in her video.
Mm-hmm.
Are you gonna? All right. And we're back. Yes, we hear that Brogan was excited.
Brogan?
Brogan from Ireland was
Brogan.
Brogan from Ireland was all excited.
I thought you were saying broken. That's why I was like,
No. I was like, nothing's broken yet.
That's so sad. So fast.
So fast. Yeah. All right, we have another question. This one's from Leila from España, la madre patria. You got me on money. Layla, what is your next tattoo, Miss LP?
Oh my goodness. Well, you know, I don't know. I have a lot of ideas. I mean, you know, I've had a lot of time alone to think about this, like, you know, all these months. I don't know. I have several ideas. I don't know.
You don't know. That's a fair answer.
Something that's like sailor-ish, you know, like the normal, my normal sailor vibe, you know. I'm like they always mean something.
We hadn't noticed that you like the sailing vibes at all. What gives it away?
In you know, put that emoji in the
emoji there.
I don't know, but yeah. So it'd be something like that.
Something nautical.
Something classic. Something probably nautical. Something nautical.
Ooh.
Oh.
Ooh, that was a good nautical. Oh. I like that. Talking about time in your hands. What have you been doing during COVID? I mean, you've been working a lot. You know, you released the live album, Live in Moscow. Yeah. A couple of singles, videos. Yeah. I mean, you've stayed pretty busy, right?
You know, I work on songs. Like, I mean, I work on songs. I work out. I do yoga. I like do the Peloton bike. You know, I drink a shit ton of wine.
Yep. Yep.
You know,
join the club.
Yay!
Yes.
Winos unite. I mean, I don't know. You know, like it depends. And then you get like so like sick of that whole thing, but a little bit is nice.
Yeah, but you spend time with your loved ones and your doggy.
Laura and I cook dinner and stuff like that, you know. I wish I could say I've become a good cook. She's become a great cook. I'm just like, yeah, that's great. Thank you.
In my belly, please.
I mean, I miss going like out to restaurants. That's my biggest like thing. That's like probably my main, you know, my, like most people, I guess, or not, honestly not, most selfish people. My main two extravagances is like meals and clothes, you know. So I like that. You know, I miss that part. You know, kind of like just going out to restaurants.
Yeah, and I'm sure you miss like people in your concerts, right?
Oh God, I mean that's what
because you had to drive in concert, and like was that weird? Just having like beep beep beep.
I know.
Beep,
it's just, I mean, you know, cars next to each other. It's just like I mean, I just was like, you know, it's like. A lot to wrap your head around, to be honest. You're just like, hey, you know, pointing at cars. What's up? Yes, Subaru, that's you. Sue. Yeah, it's weird.
Okay, well, hopefully that'll change soon.
Yeah.
We hope, you know. I miss going to clubs and like
touching sweaty bodies.
Oh, yeah, I mean, yeah, sure. Sweaty bodies. I mean, I like looking at the sweaty bodies.
There you go. Not necessarily touching them.
No, I get in there. No, I don't mind touching them. You know what I mean? Like it's. I always go down there as much as I can. You know. But it's. But yeah, I miss like it's hard to believe. Like you know, I just have so many, like, snapshots in my brain of like looking at these crowds. You know, and being like, wow, I can't believe how close like people are standing. Mm. Right now, like I would be like, oh God, okay. Gonna have a panic attack.
Are you a little claustrophobic?
No, but you know, I'm actually good like with that. I can deal with it. But I feel like it could be a little much, especially, well, you know, I really want to go and be able to go like grab a beer. Like I look at these people and like, yo, you are locked in that shit for a minute. Like there was this one club in Canada. It might have been Montreal or something like that, but I remember there was this super tall dude, and he's just cutting through all, you know, like my crowd is like, you know, predominantly women, I guess. like 70, 30 maybe, maybe more. But
maybe 80, 20.
But he's just like, and he was tall for a man too. He must have been like 6'6". And it was just like, but I was like, yes, this is the crowd I'd be in. I'd be like, yo, giant man, over here with the beers.
Bring the beers. All right, unfortunately, we are not having any beers right now, but maybe after.
Yeah,
let's go to the third song that you chose, and it's by the queen I mean, Queen of Soul, pretty much.
Queen of Soul, yeah.
Yeah, American singer, yeah. Songwriter, activist, a little bit of everything, yeah. Aretha Franklin. And this is Spirit in the Dark.
Yeah.
It was released in 1970. Why this song? Well, I mean, she has
just because, mega like, songs. Aretha, like, you know, even though I don't usually state a lot of times, like, the musically, like, as many women as men, I kind of forget sometimes, but it's like, I think it's like, I don't know what it is, but there's so many, you know. Aretha Franklin, Chaka Khan, and Joni Mitchell were like three of my go-tos. Pat Benatar, that I really kind of like taught me how to use my voice. Like I tried to like, you know, grab all those different, you know, like, and these are just like this quintessential singers to me, like of different, you know, genres. Like Joni Mitchell taught me all that high stuff and just singing along with them. But Aretha, you know, Aretha for me, like, really kind of showed me that like kind of wail that I was able to do, you know. And Spirit in the Dark, I mean, there's so many. There's like a greatest hits record that's not on Spotify that I had that I loved. And I mean, I can't not sing that song. I am getting the spirit. You know, like, I'm just like, what? I can't stop myself from singing it. Like a lot of those like classic joints, I just can't not sing. So.
Well, Sarah and I were talking about you doing a collaboration with Stevie Nicks.
Stevie Nicks.
See, my accent came out.
Well, there you go.
Like,
there's another one. I can, like, you know, I mean, I can kind of do like a little Stevie kind of like vibe. And it'll be in some of my songs that people, like, I had a song, Dreamcatcher, on my last record. You know, I was just like trying to channel some Stevie Nicks, you know, without dead on trying to sound like I was ripping her off.
Right.
But, you know, I mean, she's incredible.
But Stevie, if you're out there, you're by any chance looking at this live stream, come
on.
Yeah,
Stevie's watching this live stream. Come
for
on.
For sure.
I mean, what has she got to
for
do?
Sure, exactly. All right, let's throw it to Aretha Franklin, and here is Spirit in the Dark.
I am getting the spirit in the dark. Getting the spirit in the dark. People moving, falling, grooving. Just getting the spirit in the dark. Tell me, sister, how do you feel?
Tribute to him, and they asked me to sing This Land Is Your Land, and I did.
Okay.
And
yep. Oh, we're back.
Are you back?
Yes.
Are we?
Yes. There's Daniel's arm.
All right.
Yep, we're back. This is live stream, people. It happens. It's all good.
Yo, that ain't a perfect science, you know?
But anyway, you were telling me a little story.
Oh. Just that I was singing as far as like my proximity to Stevie Nicks. So I was singing for this Songwriter Hall of Fame induction, and it was like they were gonna have like a special award for Woody Guthrie, who's like, you know, an Americana, like the OG, like kind of pre-Bob Dylan or like around Bob Dylan, kind of like Americana, like kind of like politically charged singer, amazing. He wrote This Land Is Your Land. And I was singing a version of it with a band called Take Six, which is like an a cappella men's group. And I remember I was going on, I had to go on after like Bette Midler and Stevie Nicks were on stage. And I think that like they were talking about like that movie, that old movie that Bette Midler was on, in The Rose, and Stevie was singing The Rose. I was like, I was backstage freaking out. Like, I get mildly nervous, but this was incapacitating nervousness, and I was like,
you're like, oh, frozen.
Oh, yeah, I don't know if I can do it, you know. And it was just me starting out alone. And speaking of people, I think Aretha Franklin and like Clive Davis were in the audience.
Oh,
and like,
God.
I mean, I almost like, you know, like the term "shat yourself" comes to mind, but it felt like that kind of thing.
All right, moving on from shatting yourself. To, you know, that was a really real moment, and the next song is So Real by Jeff Buckley.
Oh, I mean, so Jeff
why,
Buckley.
Yeah,
is,
why this song and why Jeff?
Well, Jeff Buckley, first of all, you know, I think the only reason why I can understand, you know, like a certain level of fandom is because I felt like that, you know, even though I didn't do what my beautiful fans do for me, which is, you know, wait in line and all that stuff, and, you know,
and make create sure teams. You have so many teams.
Oh my God. Yeah, I didn't, you know, and, you know, we didn't have that kind of thing then anyway, but, you know, I never joined a fan club. I don't know, like, that kind of thing, but I was such a, I remember I was, like, surprised at myself when I got his record, and, sorry, I stopped playing with that, when I got his record that was his posthumous record, the record that was kind of, like, put together by his mother and his bandmates, and it was, like, the record that he didn't do, that was, like, basically compiled from his demos that he made before his death. Mm-hmm. And I just remember, like, this very sick feeling about, like, that this person, like, I was never going to hear new music from this person.
Right.
And it showed me, like, the responsibility that you have, like, once you connect, you know? And I felt that a lot when things first started getting really, like, bigger. I'd be, like, on stage and always feeling very, like, kind of, like, grateful and stuff, which I attribute to, like, you know, how difficult things were coming up. But I would feel that. But then I had this extra thing that felt like this, like, a responsibility toward these people that cared so much about my music and me. And so, you know, I just think that, like, it really is, like, you know, he was one of my favorites, and he taught me that, I feel like. He taught me how much it means to, like, want music from somebody and the loss of it if you don't get it.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think his voice was unbelievable. Like, I love singing his songs, too. He also can, you know, taught me some things, and I was just blown away by him. He was, like, almost like one of those, like, he was like a comet, you know, like, he was too bright and too insane to, like,
and yeah,
lost.
What a tragic loss too. But
yeah.
I was looking at this video Surreal yesterday, and a lot of the comments were like, I miss you, we miss you.
Oh my God. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, I think, you know, you always miss people, but like the fact that he put out Grace at that, again, a masterpiece of a record in my opinion. And then, like, to never get to hear another thing. And you know, I think that he really blasted off everybody. Like, you know, all the bands that, like, kind of became like bands like Radiohead and stuff like that, that, like, kind of came out of that time. And I feel like he was the leading, like, you know, leading light in that, in a way, for me.
All right. Well, here you go, guys. This is Jeff Buckley, So Real.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sleep tonight on your couch. I remember the smell of the fabric of your simple city dress.
You know
what the
songs?
Worst is when you go into a session with someone really big and you're just like, or not even, like, they don't even have to be big. They just have to be, like, kind of, like, have a big hit, and you can't stop singing their song, and you're like, yeah. Or like, you feel like, you know, you literally just looked them up, you know, like someone who's, like, newer but has had a hit, and you're just like, you were just in your car, like, kind of, like, trying to figure out who the hell they were. I try not to do that usually. I don't even know how big a person is or whatever.
All right, well, we're going to a question from Chris. The question is there a lesser-known, undiscovered artist who'd you...
I, you know, and he's not lesser-known in my country. It's not really lesser-known. I don't know, like, you know, like Rye, I love. And,
oh, my God, Rye's awesome.
I'm really into this song called Helpless right now.
Doesn't he live here?
Yeah, I guess.
Come
so.
On, let's make that happen, Rye.
But you know, there's a guy named Tamino, who I'm obsessed with. That I I discovered, because I was just like, I was like looking online, something, somebody else saw his picture, and I was like, oh, he's really cute. Look at that. Hey. I was like, he's beautiful. Look at him. And I clicked on it. I was like, I still got it. Yeah. But I can notice a hot man, you know. But yeah.
Did you surprise yourself?
Poetic and everything.
What's his name again?
Just so Tamino, T-A-M-I-N-O.
Tamino.
And you know, he was really starting to get up some, like, kick up some steam, like, as far as selling out and all this stuff, as he was, as we were going into lockdown. He's the last show I saw.
Oh, wow.
Before lockdown. I was like, I am not missing this, because I have this bad feeling that if I miss this guy play at this small place, I'm not going to see it again. I was so stoked, because it was just him with his guitar on stage, and mind-blowing, like, exactly like you would have thought the record was playing.
Oh,
and
nice.
Yeah,
nice.
It was sick.
Well, talking about mind-blowing, your last song that you picked that has inspired you in some way is Black Dog by Led Zeppelin.
Yeah. Hey, mama. I just think, like, Led Zeppelin, man, is just the sexiest fucking rock band of all time to me. Like, you know, all I want to do when I'm, like, listening to Led Zeppelin is get down.
And
you know, it's just like good.
And I feel like all Led Zeppelin songs kind of like take you on a journey.
Yeah, I mean, they're just like, there's something about it, like, that just like, you know, again, like the fact that they can put in these moments that, like, are not pop, but, like, you know, they're popular. Like, they're just like, they're catchy, and like, and you want to sing them over and over, and like, it's just, it's got like this depth, and again, this darkness, you know, which can bring you to, like, my new song. Like, you know, I do a lot of, like, bright, happy kind of stuff, but, you know, I mean, I got my thing, you know.
Your dark side too.
Hell yeah.
We'll be talking about How Low Can You Go, which is your new single, and that darkness a bit when we come back from Black Dog from Led Zeppelin.
Said the way you move gonna make you sweat, gonna make you groove. I got a way to shake that thing, gonna make you burn, gonna make you stay. Hey, baby, when you walk that way, watch honey drip, can't keep away.
Hello, Can You Go? And we talked to the video, and that's it.
Okay. Sick. I like it.
Okay. Seems like I'm back.
Pilly, look on the goddamn screen.
I think we're back. Are we back? Yes. All right, so that was Black Dog by Led Zeppelin. That was your last...
You can actually... I do a version of that that's on YouTube somewhere, and I do it at... It's from Bardot. And it's, like, actually one of my favorite ones that's been captured at Bardot. And it, you know, I'm kind of looking at the words on my phone, because that's what I used to do. Like, that was my kind of off the cuff, because they'd be like, a big difference between singing a song by yourself without, like, prompting from, like, singing along with it.
Right, right.
You're like, oh, shit, I'm like...
Have you ever forgotten any lyrics? Yours?
Yeah. I forgot my lyrics at my show last week, yeah.
There you go. It happens.
Yeah.
Happens to the best of us.
I jumped in the wrong place. I, like, Into the Wild, I didn't do a double chorus or something like that. Whatever. You know, like...
Yeah.
I mean, it's live.
It happens. All right, well, congratulations on your new single.
Thank
the
you.
Long-awaited... How Low Can You Go? The video is phenomenal. It dropped today, so make sure to check out the single and also the video. Mm-hmm. Shot in Mexico. Seems like there's a little like Day of the Dead inspiration there.
Yeah, like we didn't want to go too dead on, like even with like her, like, you know, we didn't want to go like super Sugar Skull kind of thing, you know. But yeah, there's like a, you know, and you know, it's no secret, I always say how Mexico is very, you know, deep in my heart, you know. And
Mexico en la casa.
And I really like, you know, I feel very like kind of inspired there always. And, you know, I have a whole bunch of people I know down there through a friend that passed away.
Yeah, I knew him.
Renato, yeah. And so, you know, when I, and even like, you know, his life is like kind of like a, you know, I didn't really mean to make this, you know, comparison or anything, but his life is like an example of like the dark side of like, you know, being a, you know, a wild like kind of creature of the night who's mm-hmm. like, you know, just like having a good time. And I think, you know, how low can it go started with that first line about like we were talking about this person, this artist that I we all like, that we were like kind of were like interested in kind of not emulating the song, but like something that had that kind of slinky sexy thing to it. And I said, Leah, last time I saw her, we did, you know, blah,
yeah.
blah, blah.
Yeah.
And it just started off
from
there.
You can say it, coconut.
Yeah, coconut glass.
Yeah.
And it just was like, it became like this kind of, just like almost like a creative writing kind of thing to talk about those wild nights and how they kind of like, they kind of seep into your whole life and, you know, and how you meet people that you may have like, you could have gone down a road with and you don't, you know, like it's just like that, like there's a, and then you don't, but like you can like, you'll always like think like, oh, what are they doing right now?
Right, or what could have happened if I would have
happened, you know, yeah. Even down from like, you know, even like friends or like, you know, like what if I did, you know, stay up, you know, go on a 3-day bender with mm-hmm. these people that were doing that, you know?
Right, yeah.
And all kinds of stuff like how that like, you know, could change your life or, and it's very, yeah, I think it's like, This song, like this video, is like kind of more of like kind of like fantasy, kind of like what if kind of land, you know, and like and just like trying to explore, but like that these things also mean a lot, you know. They're like they're real, you know, if you're thinking them.
And they make an impact in your life.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, this is the end. We're gonna leave you guys with the U.S. Latin premiere of LP's new video, How Low Can You Go, LP. It's been such a pleasure. You're awesome.
You,
I love you too.
Big distance hug for you.
And thank you everyone who tuned into this live stream. Yeah. Your fans, I mean, I've interviewed Shakira, Gwen Stefani, like nobody has fans like LP.
Come on.
It's true, I swear to God, it's true. And Sarah can attest to that. She was helping me, and everybody can attest to that. Your fans are the best, you know that too.
No, I know, thank you, I love you guys. I do, yep. I do. And I'm so lucky. I can't wait to get, you know, back out there and like kind of see everybody. And I don't know, it's, you know, it's a wild time. But I think, you know, speaking of like appreciation and feeling responsible, it's just like I'm gonna be like right back out there, appreciating and feeling, you know, responsible for these beautiful people who like my shit.
And we can't wait for that. So thank you again, LP. Thank you, everybody, for tuning
in.
And here is How Low Can You Go, LP's newest single.
Closet at the Chateau Marmont, we were happy and on it. There were two. living.